My name is Joanne Rudolph. Today is October 19th, 2007, and this is the Fortunoff Video Archive for Holocaust Testimonies at Yale University.
My name is Susan Millen.
My name is Hannelore Howard, and I was born in Berlin, March 28, 1925.
What if you could tell us a little bit about your family, what it was like growing up in Berlin?
My grandmother's name was Aaron, and I remember we had two nameplates outside the rental place. Don't know how to say that. And I remember even as a fairly young child to put my hand on the Aaron plate so nobody would see this Jewish name. And that was maybe before I was 10 even that I realized this was not a good thing to have. And my father, who was Aryan, eventually had my grandmother really live with us. Originally, she lived by herself. And I don't remember much of grammar school. That was only a four-year school. And then I went to what was called Oberschule für Mädchen, higher school for girls. We only had girls in that school, for languages. And we started with French and then added English 2 years later. But the important thing for this story is that I remember that we had two Jewish girls in our class and that they couldn't come anymore. And then they sent me home with a questionnaire which asked whether any one of my parents was Jewish. And I didn't bring the questionnaire back. Days after days, too bad I forgot the questionnaire. I wasn't about to be looked upon as a second-class citizen, and I managed to have that teacher forget about it. But eventually, you know, it couldn't be hidden. I remember one time later on, I don't know what age I was, that the teacher asked me directly. You know, she had this school class book. And I said, I don't know where I got the nerve from. I said, I'm half Aryan, didn't you know that? What a nerve. And she wrote it down as small as she could. So she obviously was in sympathy with me and not with the Nazis. And as I kept going to school, I was prohibited from certain things. I mean, all the other girls were in a group of girls called Bund Deutscher Mädchen. And of course, I wasn't worth joining that. And one time I know somebody came in and said, there was a sailing program. God, would I have loved that. Yeah. But half Aryan kids couldn't do it, of course. And, I went through school all right, but my twin brother, who was not good in school and had repeated a year, couldn't finish school. So he had to get out of school, which was not too bad for him because he was an artist. Mm. And after I graduated from high school, the whole Rosenstrasse experience happened at the very end of school.
Right, can we go back a little before we go to that?
Okay.
This was your mother's mother that lived with you?
Yes.
And how did your mother identify herself?
She was Christian. She was baptized as a baby. So we knew nothing else but celebrate Christmas, and it was a big festival. But if you mention my grandmother again, my grandmother had gotten a notice maybe in July 43. she should be ready to be deported. And I was home. My mother was home, and these Nazis came and told her she had to come with them, this old woman, 78 years old. And as she walked out, she said, "You must just think now I'm dead." And she was told, or we were told, she would be deported to Theresienstadt, which was the best camp there was, supposedly open to the Red Cross. But my brother found out much, much later. She was deported in November, and she... thank you. She was dead in December. And I was glad that she wasn't subjected to, I don't know how she died, though, you know. Did they kill her? Did she have something to kill herself? I always hoped maybe she did, but I can't imagine that she got through there with anything. So,
This was in 43.
It was in November 42. I'm sorry.
42.
The Rosenstrasse was in 43. Yeah. November 42. I'm glad you asked.
It was now, what did it mean to you when you got this notice that she was to be deported? What did it mean to you then?
See, I didn't know that she had gotten this notice. My parents raced home. We were on vacation. This was summer vacation. And told us she had had a light heart attack. I don't know when I found out that she would be deported until it actually happened. I don't recall knowing, though I'm sure she had a suitcase packed. But when they actually came, I don't think there was with direct warning right then.
Did your grandmother think of herself as Jewish?
No.
No.
Yeah. I really remember her saying, "I always thought I was German." And you know, her only son had been killed at the end of World War I. Didn't matter at all. She was still Jewish. And her family, as she said, had been in Germany for generations. And I don't think she ever darkened the door of a synagogue. Many of the German Jews were German, you know, they were well educated, many of them, and they weren't religious, period. But she was a good grandmother. She was full of stories, and she sewed, and it was nice to have her around. It's strange when the kids still cry about it. 70-year-old. I once said, "I will never forgive for the Nazis." And I don't think I can. I don't know how to do that. But, you know, maybe other people have done that too. I minimized it. I said, you know, I only lost my granddaughter. Look at all the people who lost whole families. And I wished people who think Holocaust didn't happen. They're crazy. I don't know where they're coming from. Sure happened. So maybe that's why it's still hard to think about it, because at the time I just had to keep going. So where should I continue?
So after she left,
this was the very end of my high school No, it was year before I graduated from high school. We got one note from her, you know, they collected them maybe in the Rosenstrasse, for all I know, but I don't know where they collected the people. She sent a note back that her glasses had broken and could we send her glasses. Mm. And whether she got them at all, I don't know. But that was the only thing we ever heard. And when I went to Prague several years ago with the Orchestra of New England, and we went into a synagogue that was covered with names. It was quite an experience. And I asked the person who led it, do you have Theresienstadt there? Because they had all the camp names on one wall. And she said, yes, but it was in Czech, so mm-hmm. I didn't recognize it. And, you know, the names there were just all Czech people. So my grandmother was named, her name wasn't there. Her name was Marta Aaron. You would probably pronounce it Aaron, no. Her husband was Jewish too, but I never knew him. He died very young.
Now, you spent the next year at home, continuing school.
High school.
Do you have any memory of your parents discussing what had happened to your grandmother?
The only thing I remember is that it probably was the very same day that my mother just cried in my father's arms. I don't remember much talking about it.
Now, were there any ramifications for your mother in terms of her having two Jewish parents?
Well, you know, I remember going shopping, and both my grandmother and my mother had ration cards stamped with J. I mean, all over. You couldn't miss it. And I would sort of put them below some other cards, our cards, when I went shopping, so it wouldn't be so obvious. But she was so well known and respected that probably they didn't care. You know, they used to still have special stores like a bakery and Metzger, where you bought meat mm-hmm. and different things. So that was obvious. But at one point, and I really don't know which year that was, my mother had to go to the inner city to pick up her ration card. And we had heard that they sometimes had trucks there and just loaded them up and drove them away. And I was scared every time she went to the inner city to pick up her card, but nothing happened to her. And that was already a little bit later. It may have been 44.
Now, your card did not have a J on it.
No. I mean, until the Rosenstrasse deportation, the mixed marriages and children were protected. My father didn't lose his job until the winter of 44. And then he was conscripted to work on an airport out of near the Elbe somewhere. And I was, now I'm jumping the Rosenstrasse thing, but I was conscripted to work in the streets of Berlin trying to clear gas mains from bricks. I mean, Berlin was very largely destroyed. And we were out there, when I say we, they were all half-Aryan children. And it was hard. It was cold. And I'm a pianist, and my hands, of course, were frostbitten, and my feet were frostbitten. And it was, the only good thing was that there were several of us, and we would sing or talk to each other, but we'd be out there for hours until the war ended.
Did you live at home?
Yes. That year I lived at home.
And did your father live at home after he went to work to forced labor at the airport?
No. It was way out of town. And my brothers, too, you know, they weren't luckily worth being soldiers, so they were conscripted to work behind the front, rebuilding things.
So they were gone also from the home?
Yes. Uh-huh.
So it was you and your mother?
This was from December 44 to 45, just the two of us. Mm-hmm.
Let's go back.
Okay.
So you finished high school.
Well, this brings up the Rosenstrasse, because yeah. I happened to be home to study for the final exam. I mean, the Abitur, so-called. And without warning, I mean, the bell, you know, I finally wrote about it in 88, 45 years after it happened. The bell rang, like, aggressively, bing, bing, like that. And in came two Nazis, and they set my mother down, and they talked to her, maybe not realizing she was a Jewish part. I don't know. I mean, she was very attractive and nice and all that. And finally they said, they realized it. Maybe they knew all along. You have to come with us. No warning. None. And if any of your children are home, they can come with us too. And I was home and I heard it. I was sort of behind. We had the door was open. She was in a little in-between room, you know, that. There was a hall leading from there, and I heard it, and I thought, out the side door and flee, you know. Then I said, I can't leave her. And besides, I couldn't have gotten away anyway. There was a truck out there, which I didn't know, with somebody with a rifle.
And where were your brothers and your father?
My father was at work.
So he was still working?
This was still 43. He was working. And I don't know where my brothers were, to tell you the truth. So I called my father, who worked in a bank in the center of the city, and he wasn't there. I said, tell him to come home as fast as he can. And then I started packing some stuff for my mother and me, because she just couldn't move, that's what I remember. And did it as slowly as I could, because I was hoping my father would still get home. And he came just as I walked us out the door. It's hard not to cry just thinking what he looked like. Helpless, white, stricken, you know. Standing there letting your wife and your daughter be walked out of your house for what kind of a Schicksal, what is Schicksal? Suddenly I think German. What kind of a future, you know? So they walked us out and they put us in this truck with canvas sides and canvas top. And sort of benches along the side. There were some people sitting there already. And there was a guy with a rifle in the back guarding us. And they drove us actually just around the corner and a little bit further than our house. And my father came running after us with blankets, thank goodness, because it was cold. And we drove through the whole day through the city picking up other people. You know, it was so awful. People would collect and stare at us. It was something to look at. So we ended up in the Rosenstrasse, which was also in the inner city. And I'm sure it was a schoolhouse. It had, might have been a Jewish schoolhouse. They took our identity cards and let us go in one of the rooms. And, you know, there was nowhere to sit, nowhere to sleep. There were maybe two mattresses on the floor, and there were mothers with small children taking those. What I mostly remember is that there was another young man, maybe my age, and we sort of hooked up together and we started walking through the building and up the staircase in the back. And what we saw there were Jews with cardboard around their neck, like animals taken to the market or to the slaughter. It was a terrible experience, you know, to see that. And so we heard a lot of noises outside, but we didn't know what it was. It turned out it were, those were the women, bless them, who were shouting. I mean, the movie, did you see the movie?
I know the story, but I didn't see the movie.
The movie really showed that they just kept going. I think this whole thing that this whole taking people lasted probably a whole week, and we might have been towards the end, but they came day by day and they shouted, "We want our husbands back, we want our women, our children back." And I still credit them because the next night, I think we had been picked up on a Friday, I'm not even sure, and the next night on a Saturday they gave us back our identity cards and said it had been a mistake. Mm. So we went back home.
Mm. Were the other people in your room released as well?
Oh, everybody went home, I'm sure. I'm not sure that I paid attention. We were so relieved. No, I think, well, here's in the movie, they show that they took a whole truckload of men. I don't know that we had any men except this young boy in our room, that they took a whole truckload and deported them. And I've seen some report of a symposium in Berlin where some people had written about it. Apparently, they were sent home again, too, eventually. Oh, what I forgot, my father was told. My brothers were in school, you know, and you can bring them to a certain place. I don't know, it was kind of assembly place, and he took them. What do you do, you know? And apparently he was told it was a mistake, you can take them home again. Mm. So they was fortunate.
Now, when you arrived home, did your father know that you were coming home?
I don't think so. I just know that we came home and he was at home and my mother saying something like, "We are home again now." Mm-hmm. And I... I wrote that in the story too. He came and kissed me goodnight and said, "Forget if you can." Forget if you can. Mm-hmm. But how can you? The thing is, you know, as we rode through the streets, I kept thinking, "Are they going to ask me to choose my mother, mm-hmm. or are they going to ask me to choose my father?" Now, if I choose my mother to stay with her, what guarantee do I have that I will stay with her? If I choose my father, he may be left completely alone. I mean, it was a crazy idea. They would never have asked me, I don't think. But that's how I was thinking, you know. And I must say that I did not know that there was such a thing as gas ovens. I didn't expect that. I expected to be taken to some kind of camp and worked so hard that maybe I wouldn't get enough to eat. And, you know, you visualize the little bit that you know, you know. And I don't think I was as scared or as I didn't realize how horrible it was till now that I'm thinking about it. You know, I think you just pull yourself together and this is what's happening. I don't know. Excuse me.
Now you're studying for the Abitur. Were you able to take the exam?
Yes. I don't know what I missed, you know. I don't know what I was particularly studying. I just know that I didn't have I didn't have what I expected from French. And I knew that if they asked me a lot, you know, directly, I could talk French. I could speak French very well at the time. And so I increased got a better note. I don't know what to call it. So I remember that, yeah, I did the Abitur.
And did you feel like life was going back to normal when you went home?
I think so. I mean, I don't, you know, it wasn't normal in the sense that after Abitur, I had to go and work for a year on a farm. And there were only two women there with some children. And this was something I had to do, and I couldn't do it in a group and in a camp with my friends because they all were, you know, they were good Germans, and I wasn't, right? So I had to do that, and it was very hard. I remember cutting wood and having the axe sliced on my wrist here, and I was lucky because it just pulled it down. I mean, I have a very obvious scar there, but some of it was good, you know, outside and things grow, and I picked strawberries and all that. But during the time that I was there, Berlin was attacked twice, and you could see the waves of attack, you know, and see the, what do you call that? Goodness, sometimes I can speak English. You could see that they were attacking it, and
it was an air attack.
Air attack. Two nights in a row, and I didn't hear from my parents who were in Berlin. And I didn't know whether they were alive or not. So eventually I got a telegram, come to help us move. So I still didn't know what had happened. So I went to where we lived. It was a beautiful house. We lived on the ground floor renting. And some walls were standing, and everything had crashed down, you know. But they were alive, but that was very sad. I mean, that was not the Nazis, except that the Nazis started the war, you know. So I did that for a year, and when I came home, I had the choice of either, I couldn't go study. I always wanted to study music. It was always my dream. And I could become a seamstress, forget it, or work in an office. So I worked in an office in the inner city, and that worked out really well because I probably was a little smarter than most of the other people, and they let me write a lot of releases and things. So that wasn't bad at all. But then in December, I was, when they make you do something, what's the word to that?
Compelled. It was forced labor.
This when I was forced to work in the city with bricks and shovels and all that.
Now, your father, while you were at the on the farm, and then when you came back, was he working still?
He was still working. He was. Yeah.
And your brothers?
My brothers were probably already conscripted. You know, I'm not quite sure what time they were called. He kept his job amazingly long until the December in 44.
I'm going to ask you a complicated question.
Okay.
Your grandmother is Jewish and deported. Your mother is Jewish according to Nazi racial laws. And you're living in Germany and watching Allied planes bomb Berlin. Where were your loyalties?
Well, see, I knew that we had bombed London, we, the Germans. And I know when they bombed Dresden, I thought, well, we did it first. You know, my loyalties were, I definitely was German. You know, but I couldn't blame either the English or the Americans, except that they also didn't bother to think whether there was anything worth bombing or whether they just were trying to get us to lose all heart and, you know, all, and that part, I still, it's sad, you know. If they bombed where they knew there were war factories or something, that makes sense. But they bombed to get us down. And since the Germans started the war, I could never blame them terribly much, you know.
Did you feel like you wanted Germany to lose the war?
Yes. The sooner the better. Did I want Hitler to be killed or something? Yes. I mean, it was terrible when that plot was revealed that they had tried to kill him and it didn't work. You know, it was... By then, I had a very definite idea what... I mean, the Nazis were the bad guys. You know.
What about the people around you, your neighbors, the people that you were involved with socially, the friends of your parents and your friends? I mean, what was the feeling?
Well, you see, I had one good friend in high school. And that good friend never joined the German women's or girls club because her parents were convinced anti-Nazis and pro-Jews, and they had saved Jews, and they had friends that were Jews. So she was the only other one who wasn't part of this whole Nazi apparatus. And that was wonderful for me because she also had a father who was, she had a father who was a musician, and she loved music, and we went to concerts together, and, you know, I knew my attitude was shared. The people in my class, we had a very small class, were fine. I mean, they were nice to me. They weren't all close friends, but they were nice to me. And as far as my parents' social life, I'm not real clear on that. I know that my mother, my grandmother, was visited by the husband of a very good friend of my mother's, who was a quite well-published writer. And he came to take his books home with him because they probably had a dedication in it. And so there were two friends of my mother's who always came to visit my grandmother and my mother. They were very close. They were like, we call them aunts. But I don't remember much social life, to tell you the truth.
And your mother was not sent to any kind of forced labor?
No. She ended up being the one who didn't have to do that, thank goodness. I mean, she was fairly old already, actually.
Now, what happened when the war was over?
Oh, God. My father, who was a very sort of forceful and strong person, told the commandant of that airport that he better send them home because it wouldn't go well with him if he didn't. So my father came home. And he was there when the Russians came. And things had calmed down. I mean, Berlin had capitulated, and he decided, he was a bank director, and much of our stuff, we had a lot of silver stuff because my grandfather was a jeweler, and my father had collected pictures, and they were all in the bank vault. And he decided to go into the inner city to see what had happened. And I begged him, don't go, don't go. Well, he went. So the Russians kept him. As if the Nazis hadn't been enough. And we never saw him again. They kept him for supposedly information. In retrospect, we think they kept all the people who thought would be very strong in the rebuilding of Berlin and in the whole setup of business and all that. And he died in a Russian concentration camp. Mm-hmm. That's what happened after the war. And my two brothers got home. One of my brothers, we didn't know for a long time. And one time I came home, and my mother looked like a Christmas tree, and she said, wait till you see who's here. And I thought, I didn't know, was it my brother, was it my twin brother, or was it my father? It was my brother. And he had just smuggled himself through the woods to get home, which was dangerous at the time. So he was home, and he then was able to study at the fine arts school in Berlin, and I was able to study at the music school, which had been my dream. First, I took about a year, I think, to just get my fingers to work again. And my mother started good works. That's who she was, you know, like sending things to the East to help them out. I've forgotten what kind of organization it was.
And your other brother?
Oh, he went to the university, what was it called? He studied chemistry. You know, I'm a musician. My twin brother is
artist,
painter, and my older brother is a chemist. So we all got to go to school, and it didn't cost anything in those days. It was fantastic. And I came over here. I studied 3 years at the music school, and then I studied at the Free University, musicology, and that's when I got a scholarship to come over here. And because there was somebody, Leo Schrader, who came to Berlin to lecture, I said, God, this is the best lecturer I've ever heard. So, you know, innocently I said, where do I want to go? Yale. So that's where I ended up for 1 year, Yale Music School and graduate school. But I didn't, you know, this was without any kind of degree.
This
and
was
then I got married.
And the year that you came here?
It was 1950.
And you stayed in New Haven the rest of your life?
No. It would have been nice. I got married, and he was also a musician. He was from North Carolina, and he got a job in Wilson, North Carolina, Atlantic Christian College. Now, if you want to talk about a foreign country, it was a foreign country. We were there for 3 years, and then he got a Fulbright to Berlin. There was heaven. You know, I still knew many people there, and we had a little baby girl by then and took her to Berlin. And I reconnected with lots of friends. It was wonderful. And then we went back for another 3 years. And then he got offered the directorship of the neighborhood music school. And I've been connected with neighborhood music school for 40 years.
Mm-hmm. Now, in retrospect, thinking about your own identity, now, German, Jewish, American, Christian, how do you think of yourself?
Well, it's actually a hard question to answer, because it's fairly recently that I have sort of accepted the Jewish part, you know. I mean, in Germany, and I was likely to say I'm half Aryan. Mm-hmm. That sounds different from being half Jewish. Mm-hmm. And then I also found out if your mother is Jewish, you are Jewish. Mm-hmm. Now what? I very much feel that I'm an American and Christian. That's my primary identity. The German is my background. And I love to speak it. I'm still connected with Germany, of course, because I have two brothers and some friends there. It's only recently that I have talked more about it. And I think my hope is it will free me a little. And I mean, it is my past and it is sort of who I am. But when I first came, I kept real quiet. Don't tell people that I have a Jewish background. There's great anti-Semitism in this country, which is very sad and appalling to me. But then, you know, I have gone to a synagogue a few times, and I realized that Jews who really exercise their religion, it's almost like it's set apart. It's like a different kind of heritage, language even. And so in a sense, they set themselves somewhat apart from Americans. But I don't have any background, and I wouldn't do it. And I've been a member of an Episcopal church, St. Paul's and St. James in New Haven, since 1958. And that's very much my church and people I love there. It doesn't mean I don't have friends who are not religious. I do.
And your mother, after the war, continued also to be a Lutheran, I assume?
Yes. I don't know how much she used it, whether she went to church. We didn't talk much about it, if at all. She came over here several times. She knew English. She was very gifted with languages. But she died already in 64. And I went over there. You know, one of those gotta go things. She died in Rome, where she visited my painter brother. But I don't think she ever looked at Judaism as something that was part of her at all. And it's probably quite typical for German Jews.
Now, in terms of staying in Germany, was that ever an issue?
Nope. I wouldn't think of it. My life is here, my children.
No, I'm talking about like your parents, your brothers and your mother.
Later? No. Once the war was over, they were going to stay put. It never really came up.
So they were able to separate being German and being Nazi?
I think so. No, they never, I think, considered. Well, my brothers, you know, after the war was in school, were in school. And they were very much established there. My brother got a job there. He got his doctorate and the chemist that is in my... My twin brother had a good name, at least for a while. You know, he was interesting as a painter. But my mother, I think it really just was her home. Mm-hmm. I had anticipated that you might have asked me, did I ever consider living in Germany? And I wouldn't.
Why is that?
Because my life has been here since 1950. I have three children who live here, three grandchildren who live here, a whole host of friends. That's in the background. You know, I love to go visit. I'm going in November for 10 days, and that's very exciting. But I would never want to live there. I just have never considered it.
Did you think that when you left, that you were leaving Germany?
Not at all.
Yeah.
When I left, I was going to spend this 1 year in America and then went back to Berlin, which I loved. And sort of talk positively about America. We were supposed to be ambassadors for America. That's why we got that grant. Mm-hmm. And that's what I planned to do. But things went differently.
Now, is there anything else that we haven't asked you or that occurs to you that's important?
I think I'm done.
Okay. Well, thank you so very much for coming in.
You're welcome. I'm glad to have had the opportunity, even though it was hard to. The last 10 days or so were really difficult. But I never had any doubt that, I mean, thanks to Beatrice, who sort of inspired me to do this, I never had any doubt that I wanted to do this.
We appreciate it very much.
Now, would you also like the story I wrote, or this is good enough?
No, we would.
But I don't want to give it out of my hand without just Xeroxing it.
Oh, we can do that.
Can you do that here?
In the next building, we can, if you wouldn't mind walking over with me.
I wouldn't mind at all.
Okay.